Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the National Park Service, I'd like to welcome you to Flight 93 National Memorial. And thank you for joining us today as we remember the passengers and crew of Flight 93 and their heroic actions of September 11th, 2001. I would like to acknowledge and thank the many partners from local, state, and federal government, as well as private organizations who have made possible the development of the Flight 93 National Memorial as a place of honor and remembrance. I would like to specifically acknowledge the families of Flight 93, whose dedication to the National Memorial has been an inspiration to all of us. The Friends of Flight 93, who increased public awareness of the memorial through their ambassadors program and a variety of special programs held at the memorial throughout the year, and also the local Somerset County community and park volunteers who are so supportive of the memorial and its many programs. Without all of you, we would not be here today. In a moment, I will ask you to please rise as the Army Brass Quintet presents our national anthem. Following the singing of the national anthem, please remain standing as Reverend Paul Britton, brother of Flight 93 passenger Marion Britton, presents the invocation and leads us in a moment of silence. After the moment of silence, the bells of remembrance will then be rung, and the names of the 40 passengers and crew of Flight 93 will be read. Starting the reading will be former Flight 93 National Memorial Superintendent Jeff Reinbold. The bell ringers today are Paul Murdoch, the architect of Flight 93 National Memorial, and Joanne Hanley, who served as the first superintendent of the Flight 93 National Memorial. Please rise as the United States Army Brass Quintet presents our national anthem.
A great teacher of faith has taught that the world would not have peace, whether on small family levels or certainly not global levels, until we all learn to give ourselves away to others. And when we give ourselves, we birth peace. We are here to celebrate the giving away of self. The giving away of self to and for others. We come, therefore, to celebrate one keystone of peace in families, for a nation, and for a globe. Amen.
Christian Adams.
Lorraine Grace Bay.
Todd M. Beamer. Alan Anthony Bevan. Mark Bingham.
Diora Francis Bodley.
Sandy Waugh Bradshaw. Marion R. Britton. Thomas E. Burnett, Jr. William Joseph Cashman. Georgine Rose Corrigan. Patricia Cushing.
My brother, Captain Jason M. Dahl.
Joseph DeLuca. Patrick Joseph Driscoll. Edward Porter Felt. Jane C. Folger. Colleen L. Frazier. Andrew Sonny Garcia.
My son, Jeremy Logan Glick.
Kristen Osterholm White Gold. Lauren Katuzzi Grancolis, an unborn child.
My daughter, Wanda Anita Green.
My father, Donald Freeman Green.
Our son and brother, Richard J. Guadagno.
My son, Toshiya Kuge.
Linda Grunlund. Leroy Homer.
My family's precious jewel, Cece Ross Lyles.
Hilda Marson. Waleska Martinez. Nicole Carol Miller.
My cousin, Louis Joseph Joey Nacki, the second.
Donald Arthur Peterson. Jean Hoadley Peterson. Mark David Rothenberg. Christine Ann Snyder. John Talignani. Honor Elizabeth Wainio. Deborah Jacobs Welsh.
Our first speaker of the day is Director John Jarvis of the National Park Service. Director Jarvis has been instrumental in the development of Flight 93 National Memorial. In 2005, he served as a member of the jury for the International Design Competition that selected Paul Murdoch's design for the memorial. He has a tremendous passion for America's national parks and for Flight 93 National Memorial. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Director John Jarvis.
Good morning. 40 names. They are much more than just names. They're friends, their family, fellow travelers, heroes. Their memories live on in this field, in their photos and in their voices and in their actions, in this amazing new visitor center. We will never forget them. We do this for them. We do this for their families. We do this for all citizens who remember vividly where we were on September 11th, 2001. We do this for the next generation who were not yet born or too young to remember. We do this for a nation and a world that is still dealing with terrorists who want to tear down civil societies. And we do this as a reminder to those who wish us harm that Americans and our allies don't go down without a fight. We of the National Park Service are honored to do this. It's our mission. Next year in 2016, the National Park Service will celebrate its 100th birthday. Throughout our first 100 years, the American people have relied upon and trusted the National Park Service with our most complex and painful stories. At Valley Forge, Colonial, and Fort McHenry, we fly our flag of independence, celebrating a nation of the people, by the people, and for the people. At Gettysburg and Manassas, Antietam and Vicksburg, we keep the valor and horror of the American Civil War alive to this day. And during the recent 150th commemoration, the sesquicentennial of the Civil War, we used our parks and our interpretive power to shift the story from states' rights to slavery as the root cause of the Civil War. At Selma to Montgomery, Little Rock Central High, Tuskegee Airmen, and Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial, we tell the story of civil rights. And during this recent 50th anniversary of the Voting Rights March, we engaged young people from across the country, including from Ferguson, Missouri, to walk the 54 miles from Selma to Montgomery, challenging them to carry on the march for racial justice that began on Bloody Sunday in 1965. At Manzanar, Minidoka, and Tule Lake, we tell the story of Japanese-American confinement during World War II for no other reason than their ethnicity. And just this year, with an act of Congress, we take on the Manhattan Project, the development and utilization of the atomic bomb. And we are already partnering with the cities of Hanford, Washington, Los Alamos, New Mexico, Oak Ridge, Tennessee, and Hiroshima and Nagasaki. At Pearl Harbor and war in the Pacific and Vietnam and Korea and the World War II memorials on the National Mall, we honor our greatest generation of veterans. Every day we host veterans at the memorials brought to us by the honor flights, and we greet them with the recognition and respect they so richly deserve. And here at Flight 93, we take on the challenge of telling the story of 9/11 to a generation that experienced it, to a new generation that did not, and to an entire population that is still living with the consequences. In each case, the National Park Service takes this responsibility with the utmost seriousness. Each of these national parks represent core American patriotic values: heroism, sacrifice, honor, commitment, bravery, honesty, service, justice, inspiration, and freedom. From the snowy fields of Washington's Army at Valley Forge, to the bloody cornfields of Pickett's Charge at Gettysburg, to this field of honor at Flight 93, these fields of Pennsylvania represent the nation's resolve to achieve and protect our highest ideals. The National Park Service commits to never letting America forget how these values were forged in the hottest fires. We commit to instill these same values in the next generation and every generation into the future. Let me say that one of our great partners through this project over the last 14 years has been the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. The delegation, some who were sitting here with us today, former Governor Ridge, has been a fantastic supporter all the way through, a great partner in helping us tell the story, work with the families, and preserve this place. So it's my great honor to introduce the current governor of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. He has been deeply involved and directly supportive of this memorial. It's my pleasure to introduce Governor Tom Wolf. Thank you.
Thank you, Director, Governor. What happened in this area on this day 14 years ago changed our world. And it changed the way we Americans think about that world. It also reinforced some ways we think about each other. To this day, it has made us think differently about who we are as a nation and our place in a very puzzled world. And it also made us think about what we are capable of doing as human beings, especially as a result of what the passengers and crew of Flight 93 did on this day 14 years ago. First, the events of 9/11 changed our view of the world. It certainly changed the way we think about America's place in the world. After 9/11, we all recognized that we were not separate. We were not apart from the troubled world. We learned on that tragic day that we were in fact connected in ways we never imagined possible. We learned that the world outside was in fact no longer outside. What happened in New York City and right here on September 11th will forever be part of who we are. There are few people whose hearts were not affected by what they saw on the television screens from New York City. The image of those twin towers burning seared us to our cores. And there are equally few who can ever forget hearing or reading about what happened on Flight 93 here. What might have been had Flight 93 gone where the hijackers wanted it to go must continue to haunt us for many years to come. And this brings us to the second thing we learned on September 11th, 2001. It is that we are, each one of us, capable of doing remarkably selfless and heroic things. Because on September 11th, 2001, a handful of people, passengers and crew, made a huge difference to the course of our own history. What they did saved countless lives in Washington, D.C. What they did averted a terrible tragedy that would have taken place there had they not acted as they did here. And what they did told us all a great deal about the potential nobility that lies within each of us. Their actions on this day ennobled all of us. It gave us a remarkable example of human behavior at its best. It showed us what each of us is capable of doing, and it elicited swift and effective reactions from the people around us, around here, from emergency responders from this area, from the area residents, from good leaders like Governor Tom Ridge, who's here today, who pledged the resources of the Commonwealth to provide what it could to help, and from the folks at the National Park Service and beyond who understood that our nation needed to pay concrete tribute in the form of this center to the deeds of the passengers and crew of Flight 93. So today's memorial service is a chance for us to reflect on what these good people did. It's a good day to reflect on what it all means. They reacted nobly and bravely and voluntarily to a new world few of us were ready for. In doing what they did, they taught us something about what that new world might mean for us and what it might ask of us. And in doing what they did, they showed each of us what good we are actually capable of doing. Today, we remember what they did on September 11th, 2001. We will never forget, and we will be forever grateful. Thank you.
Jay Johnson was sworn in as 4th Secretary of Homeland Security in December 2013. The Department of Homeland Security has more than 240,000 employees in jobs that range from aviation and border security to emergency response, from cybersecurity and analysts to chemical facility inspectors. All have one clear goal: to keep America safe. Please join me in welcoming Secretary of Homeland Security Jay Johnson.
Good morning. Governor Wolf, Director Jarvis, former governor and former secretary Ridge, Senators Johnson, Carper, distinguished guests, and most of all, Mr. Felt and the other family members of those who died on United Flight 93. 14 years ago today, at 8:42 a.m., United 93 took off from Newark International Airport. For those on board and for all of us, it was a typical Tuesday morning, except it was a picture-perfect weather day all along the East Coast. 4 minutes later, the tranquility of that day was shattered by the terrible sight of a jet crashing into the World Trade Center. By the time both towers of the World Trade Center had collapsed, our nation was forever scarred. And it was out of that dark and horrible day that the Department of Homeland Security was born. Like many Americans, I have vivid recollections of that day, which happens to be my birthday. I was at work in Manhattan that day. Jim Mikleshevsky, who will speak after me, was at work at the Pentagon that day. And as so many of us in those first few minutes and hours were focused on New York and Washington, D.C., we did not know what was happening on United Flight 93. Brought together by nothing more than happenstance, missed flights, unexpected work trips, family vacations, the 40 passengers on United 93 represented a mosaic of life experiences. Once on United 93, and once it was hijacked, however, those differences ceased to matter. Through a series of hushed and hurried phone calls, these people learned the true nature of the hijacker's mission. Armed with this information, the passengers did the most American of things. They took a vote. They voted to fight back, no matter the cost. They knew what they had to do, and they knew they faced long odds. And so they made calls to loved ones to say goodbye. Their last words were both inspiring and devastating. heartwarming and heartbreaking. In her final moments, Elizabeth Wanio thought not of herself, but of her family. She called her stepmother and told her, "It hurts me that it's going to be so much harder for you than it is for me." Todd Beamer's Airphone account wasn't working, so he ended up speaking to a supervisor to a call center in Illinois. Though they were complete strangers, together they recited the 23rd Psalm. "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil." And then, with the iconic words, "Let's roll," the passengers of Flight 93 stormed the cockpit, altered the course of history that day, and most likely saved hundreds or thousands of lives by losing their own. The terrorists who attacked us struck at what they believed were symbols of American power. In New York, our economic strength. In Arlington, our military strength. But they were mistaken. The true strength of this nation lies not in the steel and cement of an office building, but in the strength, determination, and resilience of the American people themselves. I have said many times before, terrorism cannot prevail among a nation of people who refuse to be terrorized. Just days after 9/11, thousands of people returned to work in Lower Manhattan. The very next day, after the attack on the Pentagon, my former colleagues in the Office of the General Counsel of the Air Force were back at their desk in the E&D rings. Scores of young Americans were inspired by the attacks to join the military. And the 23,000 runner Boston Marathon of 2013 was devastated by a bomb. After that, 36,000 runners signed up for the Boston Marathon of 2014. One of those runners said something that captured the essence of the character of Americans. "We are dreamers, fighters, and champions. We fall, endure pain, and get back up again. We support one another, cheer each other on, and most importantly, we never give up." Today's service, the memorial here, and the new visitor center dedicated yesterday, all remind us of the personal loss suffered at this place. But in this country, out of tragedies such as this, are also reminders of renewal, rededication, and a reminder of who we are as a nation of people who are strong, proud, courageous, and free. Thank you very much.
It's truly an honor to introduce the next speaker, Gordon Felt, brother of Flight 93 passenger Edward Felt, and president of the families of Flight 93. Gordon has also served on the Flight 93 Commission and is longtime president of the families of Flight 93. And he has been a tireless advocate of the development of this national memorial. In his role as the president, he has participated in the fundraising needed for the project while providing family oversight of the design and construction of the memorial. Please join me in welcoming Gordon Felt to the podium.
Good morning. Regional Director Caldwell, Secretary Johnson, Governor Wolf, Director Jarvis, Mr. Mikliszewski, Reverend Britton, Governor Ridge, family members that have made the journey back to our sacred ground, members of the Flight 93 National Memorial Partnership, and all of you that have chosen to be here this day. We gather together on this 14th anniversary of September 11th to mourn the loss of 40 extraordinary individuals, as well as mourn the thousands that perished at the Pentagon and in the World Trade Center. Each of us brings to this day a perspective born from either experience or a reading of history which speaks to us from deep within our hearts. In joining our commemorative service, you honor our loved ones and their collective actions by your presence, your prayers, and your passion. For 14 years, we have gathered at this site to reflect on how the world changed so drastically that September morning, and how it has continued to change with the passing of time. We view the world through different eyes and are different people now. For some reason, September 11th is a historical event that has a minimal amount of tangible relevance to some lives this day. For others, this day is a painful reminder of our own mortality. The trajectory of our lives and the course of our country have been altered immeasurably due to the events of September 11th. Yet the one constant that remains sacred to that day is the message of bravery, selflessness, and heroism. Time will not erode the actions of our loved ones. And with the opening of the Flight 93 National Memorial's Visitor Center, their story, their lives, and their collective actions will be preserved for now, tomorrow, and in perpetuity. To our colleagues at the National Park Service, the Flight 93 National Memorial Ambassadors, and the friends of Flight 93, thank you for your passion and dedication to this project. The legacy of our loved ones is in your care, and we are forever grateful to have such dedicated stewards. The intent of this memorial has always been to not only remember, but to inspire. If it was me, could I have taken action? I would like to hope so, but I hope to never have to find out. Is any challenge I face today remotely close in difficulty to that which our loved ones faced aboard United Flight 93? No. Could it have been me that morning, or any of you sitting out there? Yes. These questions can and should serve to give us perspective on our lives and inspire us to be better than we were and are, whether we are now just learning about the events of September 11th or once again reminded of the horror of the day. If we neglect to actively remember the events of September 11th, well beyond an annual recognition of Patriots Day, this altered course of history and the actions of so many heroes on September 11th would have been for naught, allowing for history to repeat itself. This site, this memorial, the actions of our 40 heroes stand as a beacon in this wilderness, reminding us of who we were, who we are, and most importantly, who do we want to be? Thank you. Jim Mikliszewski is the chief Pentagon correspondent for NBC News. He was reporting live on site for the Today Show on September 11th, 2001, when American Airlines Flight 77 hit the Pentagon. Mr. Mikliszewski also served as the White House correspondent for NBC News during the Bush senior and Clinton administrations. It is a distinct honor to be able to introduce a man so filled with a passion for the story and so professional in the manner by which he shares it with the world. It is my honor to introduce to you Mr. Jim Mikliszewski.
At the very start, I'd like to tell you all just how honored and humbled I am to be at this place on this day with the families of the heroes of Flight 93. So thank you very much. Now, I've been asked to share my recollections of 9/11 from my perspective and position at the Pentagon, but first, I'd like to tell you my experience here yesterday at this memorial. Gordon was gracious enough yesterday to give my wife Cheryl and I a personal tour of the visitor center, which is now open to the public. It was truly one of the most emotional and moving experiences one can imagine. Heart-wrenching, of course, yet highly inspirational. When you get the complete picture of the heroism and humanity of the 40 passengers and crew members of Flight 93. After taking in the exhibit, you realize they prevailed. They undoubtedly saved countless lives of other innocents and fully understood the most likely outcome, but refused to surrender. This visitor center is a living memorial to their courage. Now, I arrived at the Pentagon on the morning of 9/11. What a beautiful day it was. The temperature was just divine, a slight hint of fall in the air. And once inside, I made my usual early morning rounds. And in military parlance, there was nothing on anyone's radar. So I thought this was going to be an easy day. I grabbed a cup of coffee, settled into the NBC office on the E-ring on the perimeter of the Pentagon, and started reading the overnight dispatches. But shortly after 8 o'clock, I got a call from one of my seniors at NBC. You see, the day before, Time magazine had done a cover story predicting that Donald Rumsfeld would be the first in the Bush cabinet to be forced out of the administration. The feisty Rumsfeld had already had run-ins on Capitol Hill and even with some of his fellow cabinet members. So we talked for a short time about how we could work that into a story, but as he hung up, he said to me, "You know, Jim, what Rumsfeld really needs is a good war." 30 minutes later, at 8:46, American Airlines Flight 11 flew into the North Tower of the World Trade Center, and the U.S. was at war. Initial reports it was a small twin-engine plane just didn't make sense. I slid over to the small TV we had and put my nose to the screen. That did not look like the impact of a small plane to me. So I immediately started making phone calls to the usual sources, CIA, DIA, Defense Intelligence Agency, and the Joint Staff. When no one, not a single person, answered their phone, I got worried. Then the world watched at 9:03 on live television. United Flight 175 banked hard left into the Trade Center's South Tower. I raced out of the office, backtracking to several Pentagon sources who could only speculate that because of the large scale of those devastating attacks, it could only be the work of Al-Qaeda. From our live camera in the NBC office, I went on the air on Today, quoting sources that Al-Qaeda was the likely suspect. Back into the hallway then, I was literally run over by one intelligence official scurrying past our office. Like others, he told me this attack was so well planned, so well coordinated and executed, it just has to be Al-Qaeda. But as he turned to walk away, he stopped and turned back to me and said, "And if I were you, I would stay off the E-ring the rest of the day because we're next." Now, several hours later, outside the Pentagon, as I saw him and I walked up to him, he said, "Honest to God, I had no idea." I went back on the air with Katie Couric, reporting again on Al-Qaeda, but at this time, at the very instant I threw it back to New York, Katie, American Flight 77, traveling at 550 miles per hour, slammed into the Pentagon. As massive and solid as that total concrete structure Pentagon is, the entire building shook. Windows rattled. My immediate thought was we're under attack. I jumped up from the chair, looked out the window to see people running from the building. I stepped out again into the hallway where there was what I would describe as orderly chaos. Not a stampede, but people moving very quickly and amazingly quietly, as if they were in shock. One Army officer who hustled past me said the explosion was at the helipad at almost the opposite side of the building. I immediately sat back down in front of the camera, put on the mic, and motioned to the camera to come back to me. They must have seen the urgency on my face because Katie immediately threw it back to me. I don't want to alarm anyone, I said, but there's been some kind of explosion here at the Pentagon. Instinctively, I knew it was another airliner attack, but I obviously couldn't say for sure. And I've often thought why I chose those words, I don't want to alarm anyone, given the devastating horrors already inflicted on the U.S. earlier that morning. And I think now, because the attack on the Pentagon to me was somewhat personal, not that I felt necessarily threatened at that moment, but because that area of the Pentagon was occupied by many in the Army and the Navy, many who I knew, many who I considered friends, four of them were killed. After a couple of hours, I walked out the mall entrance closest to the crash site and into what I could only describe on the air as a war zone. There was a gaping hole in the side of the building, a ferocious fire fed by thousands of gallons of jet fuel, medics attending to wounded, medevac helicopters. While overhead, two Air Force F-16 fighter jets were crisscrossing the sky at a very low level. An Air Force colonel standing next to me, looking up, saying it to no one in particular, "My God, we're flying CAPS, combat air patrols, over the nation's capital." Suddenly, a loudspeaker blared out a warning, "Get away from the building, get away from the Pentagon, another plane inbound, another plane inbound." Many people started to run. Now, I didn't have the exact time, but I was pretty certain that was well after 10 o'clock. And only learned later that Flight 93 had already crashed here at this site. But it was clear many at the Pentagon didn't yet know that. Reporters, in fact, were first led to believe that U.S. warplanes shot down a hijacked airliner in Pennsylvania. We still at that time had not heard the words Flight 93. We peppered Pentagon and a Pentagon spokesman with questions. Did the military shoot down the airliner? Who gave the order? We got no straight answers. There was much confusion inside the Pentagon as well. Deep down beneath the Pentagon, Defense Secretary Rumsfeld had joined his top military leaders and civilian leadership in the National Military Command Center, the NMCC. Smoke from the burning jet fuel fires several floors above seeping into the space. About a year later, I obtained a handwritten notes taken in the NMCC that day that revealed the source of some of that confusion. According to the notes, 10:30, nearly 30 minutes after Flight 93 had crashed, Vice President Dick Cheney, on a conference call from the bunker, the underground bunker, somewhere in the vicinity of the White House, told Rumsfeld that he had given the order to attack any hijacked airliner, and that matter of fact, two had already been shot down. Rumsfeld, who hadn't been in the NMCC that long at that time, shot back, not confirmed. He said he was aware that a plane had gone down, but so far, there had been no American fighter pilot to claim responsibility. Even after the FAA grounded all the commercial flight, Rumsfeld, in fact, struggled with the ROE, the rules of engagement for the pilots. 11:28, I am troubled by the ROE. I'd hate to be a pilot up there and not know exactly what to do. Tell POTUS, the president, we have no granularity on ROE. Later, look, it's not simple for a pilot. Is a plane headed for the runway, the White House, or the Pentagon? And then at 12:10, the first real evidence, hard evidence, that led straight to Al-Qaeda. CIA Director George Tenet, on a call to the Pentagon, reports that an intelligence intercept of a call from a top Al-Qaeda official to Osama bin Laden contained the words, "Hello, have you heard the good news?" Back above the ground, security forces had already pushed us reporters and camera crews well back from the Pentagon to a hillside on the other side of the highway. At first, we received only sketchy numbers of casualties, no firm counts. The courtyard in the middle of the Pentagon with its majestic elm trees has always been a refuge from the daily grind of the Pentagon. On 9/11, it became a makeshift morgue. 120 people at work in the Pentagon were killed. Stories of heroism slowly trickled out. Individuals, many military, many Pentagon police, plunged repeatedly into the tangled wreckage, the concrete, the steel, and live power lines, sputtering over highly volatile fuels of jet fuel to carry out many of the injured. One Pentagon police officer credited with saving 8 lives. Now, as a Pentagon reporter, I must tell you, the most memorable stories I've ever covered have involved true American heroes, Medal of Honor recipients. And I'd like to take a moment to tell you about one. It's remarkable. In the middle of a firefight, Captain William Swenson, ambushed by enemy forces in Afghanistan, repeatedly re-entered the kill zone to rescue the wounded and recover the dead. At one point, Swenson helped carried a seriously wounded sergeant, Kenneth Westbrook, to a medevac helicopter. Then in an inexplicable, it was amazing, in a spontaneous display of compassion, with the battle raging around them, Swenson leaned into the helicopter and kissed Westbrook on the forehead. The emotional moment caught on a helmet cam worn by a medic. Westbrook later died. But it was an unbelievable, beautiful moment of compassion and love in the middle of a war. In fact, there's a common thread in every Medal of Honor story: selfless acts of bravery, sacrifice, and love for the responsibility for their fellow soldiers. And it makes the heroism of the 40 passengers and crew members on Flight 93 all the more remarkable. It's been said many times before, but the extraordinary actions of those aboard Flight 93 not only bear repeating, but must never be forgotten. Unlike our American military, of course, who have years of training and combat experience, as a team, a unified group, the 40 men and women who boarded Flight 93 were a group of everyday Americans. For the most part, they've never met, had no training, and less than 20 minutes to act. Still, they bonded together, facing impossible odds, thinking not of themselves, but of the lives of others. I, along with every military officer who have discussed the heroics of Flight 93, remain awestricken by the calm, composure, and conviction of all those on board. Who among us, for example, would have the presence of mind to think to boil water to use as a potential weapon? And how, on a cell phone, how do you tell a loved one you may never see them again? Where does that strength come from? One of the exhibits here in the visitor center has the recordings of 3 women on Flight 93. as they left messages to their loved ones on answering machines. Two to their husbands, one to their sister. Gut-wrenching, as you can imagine. But as you listen, you marvel at how calm they were. It's as if they did not want to strike fear in the hearts of their loved ones. And in fact, they sounded more concerned about how their loved ones would react after they were gone. Ultimately, by a vote, they decided they would not allow a group of terrorists to determine their fate. In the face of almost certain death, they knew they must do everything they could possibly do to prevent the loss of other innocent lives. To the passengers and crew members, there was a much greater purpose and principle at stake. The fact is, on that fateful day, while all of us were writing only the first page of 9/11 history, the 40 on Flight 93 were writing their enduring legacy of an unimaginable courage, unending inspiration, and yes, love. Thank you.
Thank you for joining us this morning to remember the selfless sacrifice of the 40 passengers and crew of Flight 93. We hope you will remember their sacrifice and be inspired by their courage and actions now and forever. This concludes our ceremony for the day. Please remain seated until family members have had the opportunity to proceed to the visitor center or the Memorial Plaza. Thank you.